So winter feeding for cattle is very problematic in the state of Kentucky because of the amount of moisture that we have, the time that it takes. So what we've done is we basically selected a great place to do winter feeding on the Eden Shale farm. We've got a natural windbreak over here to the left with these trees that'll basically provide a windbreak for the cattle to feed right here on this ridgetop. Selecting a ridgetop is one of the better places to feed. And then what we've done is we've created these what we call cubbies or fence line feeding systems to basically be able to feed cattle without going into the pasture, without rutting it up and taking a roll bale in there. So we've basically got a system where we can evaluate these different cubbies that we have and compare and contrast them over the course of years.
We're looking forward to, we're going to track how many hay bales we put through each one of these, how fast the cattle eat them through each structure, the cattle's preference, you know, do they have a preference of one of these feeders versus the other one, and just evaluate how they performed in general.
So the first one, basically we got them in order of highest quality to lowest quality. So the first one is what we call the Cadillac model. This one has a roof on it. It can hold two roll bales. It's concrete throughout, so it's got a concrete pad where we set the roll bales. It's elevated 6 inches above the cattle flooring, so we get it up out of the muck and the mire. The flooring for the cattle is grooved. We've got 8 feet from the edge of the cattle feeding area to the end to basically be able to get the whole cow on it. We got a cattle feeding gate in the back, so we can access the roll bales in the back. So the idea is you load it in from the front and you just push the roll bales back. If there's any residual, the next time you put a roll bale in, it'll come back this way. They can eat it. If they don't, you can open up this gate and push it out. So this is all concrete with a roof. We got a monoslope on the roof. It slopes it to the back so we don't have water draining on the cattle. It'll come off the back and basically go down the edge of the hill. Normally you put a spacing in here of 20 feet in between structures to be able to get two animals in, but also have a pathway for other animals to walk and move about. So 18 feet is standard. What we've done here is actually added in a 20 so we can put in two 10-foot feeding panels so we can feed a supplemental diet in between these two structures. All right, this structure right here, if that's the Cadillac model, this is the GMC model. So again, this has got concrete throughout. The only difference is it doesn't have the roof on it like we've done with this one. So we've saved some money on labor and materials by not putting a roof on it, and we can evaluate this. By not having a roof on it, you might have some rotting of the hay, but if you have multiple animals in here, it's not gonna be in there for that long, and that's basically a negligible point. So this comes out again. We got 20 feet in between these. But in this, where we transition to this next model, which would be basically the work truck model, we've gone with a concrete floor, but the gravel here, basically there's a different surface going on here. So underneath of this, we basically have a grid that's been installed. It's a honeycomb grid that they use to run tanks on at Fort Knox. And so it's a plastic material. And so the idea is if we do any scraping on this, we're not gonna go past this plastic flooring. It's more expensive to do, but it's got drainage and it gives more ductility to be on rock for the animals rather than the hardened concrete surface. And then this, instead of doing the metal panels, we basically went with a wood panel, 2x6s, with basically a 14-inch spacing for the animals to be able to reach the hay. This last one or next one of this type of structure, basically we did this all in gravel. There is no grid underneath of this gravel, so it's just geotextile fabric and rock. What I would expect to find on this, which we'll probably show, is you'll actually get some divots in here where the front feet sit, where basically the cattle are moving around and moving rock out of the way, so that'll lead to some quagmire there. And then this has also got a rock interior, so we're cutting costs as we move down the hill. So all these structures so far have been two roll bale structures, and so then we took this and we made two roll bale structures out of this. So what this is a three component hay ring structure, and we've taken out one of the sections and basically just used the other two to basically bolt it in to the fence line so the producer can come off the road, load this up with one roll bale, and to be consistent with this two roll bale system, we've added a second one down the hill. And this is all just geotextile fabric and rock, and this is about as cheap as you can get, but it makes it easier. So with this type of system, instead of going through the gate and, you know, not letting a cow come out and chase them and all that kind of stuff and deal with ring feeders or deal with trailers, you'll come right in off the farm road and load these things up and you're done.
So this is our first season of using the fence line feeding system here. It worked really well for us this spring. We're very happy with how it turned out. The cattle used it the way we expected. They didn't really have a preference of feeder. They more prefer fresh hay, depending on which feeder's got a good source of dry hay in it is what they like to go to. What you're seeing here as far as residue, we had 55 head in here for 6 weeks. So you can see about how much use that manure that created. We did not scrape it off. This is what it was here for the full 6 weeks of what was generated. So one season can easily, we can easily manage the manure load that comes off of these feeders.
One of the limiting factors of these cubbies is when you have that feed in there is this water right here. So any cattle producer knows that if you got food and water in the same location, the cattle never leave. So we've set it up so we've developed a spring over here so we can provide free water for the cattle, which will allow us to shut this down so the cattle can use their natural path and use that position over there to get water, come over here, get a bite, leave, go down the hill, or go back around. So we'll move this water away so we limit the amount of manure that we're going to be collecting over here. So you don't expect any kind of wear that's going to occur on the concrete because it is concrete. It's durable, indestructible, so to speak, if it's placed properly. So we've got the concrete surfaces that are working well. We've got these, the cubbies are all working well. They pretty much got the same amount of use because they all had hay in them. And cattle pretty much are indiscriminate as far as using them because we've got them all set up as far as the elevation. So they're all in the same position. And then this one right here, this structure's the one that has the plastic grid. Of course, you can't see the plastic grid with the manure pack that's on top of it, but that's okay. But you don't see any depressions. And you don't really see any depressions until you get over to the surfaces that we used in geotextile fabric and rock. There's an ever so slight of a depression around this one, a little bit more around the hay structures that we've got on the ends, but that's pretty much exactly what we expected. Over time, geotextile fabric and rock is gonna wear. You need all-weather surfaces for raising cattle in the state of Kentucky, but even all-weather surfaces like geotextile fabric and rock are gonna get sloppy. And because of the water and the infiltration and stuff, it's gonna loosen up. So it's a kind of a deferred cost. If you use the concrete, you're gonna put it in once and you're gonna be one and done. If you use the rock, you're gonna have to come back probably in 7 years or something like that and fill that those depressions in. The problem is that rock will not adhere if you got a manure pack on it. So it's kind of deferred cost too that you're also hauling away rock. If this is gonna get more wear and more use, you might as well have put it in concrete. Now, as far as how much hay is left, as far as what the cattle couldn't reach, that's just a design issue. So on the ones with the metal panels, we're looking at maybe 20 inches of waste. On the ones with the wooden panels, we're looking at 40 inches of waste. But again, with the concept of taking that next row bale and pushing it in and the cattle feeding off the back, as long as it's good quality hay, they'll eat it. And the other thing too is depending on the load as far as how many animals are in here, that hay is not going to be there, so the quality is not going to be impacted that much. The great situation about this is we're storing the hay under roof, so it's not at the mercy of the elements or the weather. So basically we got good quality hay and they're eating it.
This system was surprisingly or very easy to use as far as coming down. They're located close to the hay barn. Come down here, fill them up. It was very simple and time effective to use as we anticipated. We had the gates hanging on the front of them in case we got calves inside the feeders, but we didn't have any of that going on. So we actually could have eliminated those gates and not necessarily had to use those, and it would have been even quicker time, load times for each feeder. So this implementing not only this fence line feeding system, but some other feed pads and barn facilities that Dr. Higgins has helped us develop has allowed us to completely change our management here at the farm. We actually now, because these systems were put in the correct place, were located correctly and put in the correct location as far as summit positions and access to water, those kind of design elements were implemented correctly. It's allowed us to change the flow and the management of cattle here at the farm. So before I was pulling my cows out of the woods up when they're getting ready to calve and putting them in this location, but it was steep and it got muddy, so it ended up being problematic. And now because of these other structures, I actually move them to other pastures first, calve them out, and then as they calve, bring them over to this spot and let them finish March and April over here in this spot when the mud's the worst. Because now we've got this sun position, we've got a hardened area for them to stand on. So no, we're not eliminating mud on the farm. You'll always have mud, but you can manage what time of year you're in mud and when the cattle are exposed to that mud. So that's allowed us to put them over here on this hardened area when it's the most muddy time of year.